Good morning and welcome to worship from Grahamston United Church. The psalmist says, I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications, because he inclined his ear to me. Therefore I will call on him as long as I live. What shall I turn to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful ones. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant, the child of your serving girl. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer you a thanksgiving sacrifice and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord. We now join together in the hymn, Give Thanks with a Grateful Heart. Thanks that you remain ever by our sides during this testing time, giving us support and comfort. Thanks that you share our sadness and frustration as a result of the confined lifestyle we are obliged to follow at present. But most of all, we give thanks for your Son, Jesus, who during his time on earth demonstrated your love through his acceptance and care for all your people, regardless of who they were or how they were. We give thanks that the risen Christ still lives among us through your Spirit. And so it is with thankful hearts that we gather together this day in spirit, if not in person, to offer you our praise, to offer you our worship, to offer you our prayers of adoration, confession, and supplication. Loving God, we are only too aware that regardless of all you have taught us, and no matter how hard we try to follow Jesus, we remain flawed individuals. We complain about our situation. We judge others harshly, condemning rather than offering forgiveness. We neglect to seek your guidance when we most need it, and forget to acknowledge these occasions when you have rescued us from difficulty. At times we make you in our own image rather than accepting that we are made in your image. And as a result, we do that which we assume you would tell us to do, rather than waiting to hear your still small voice telling us what you would have us do. Gracious God, we ask your forgiveness for the many times we have let you down, and we seek your help once more to be the people you would have us be, to live as you intended for us, to demonstrate your abiding love in all we do, and in all our dealings with our brothers and sisters, your children, regardless of our own feelings. This we ask through Jesus Christ, our Saviour and Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever. Amen. Ruth Donnelly will now lead us in our scripture lesson.
Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 8. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us.
We join together in singing the hymn, O God, our help in ages past.
Thank you.
Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 to chapter 10, verse 8. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the labourers are few. Therefore ask the Lord of the harvest to send out labourers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus. Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. "Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment." Amen.
I recently watched a film entitled Paul, Apostle of Christ. It's set quite some time after Paul wrote his letter to the Romans. It's set at a time when Paul was in prison in Rome and the Christian community there were effectively in lockdown. They were in hiding because the Emperor Nero blamed the Christians for starting a fire that destroyed much of Rome. Rumour has it that he started the fire himself, but certainly the Christians were not to blame. Nevertheless, Nero rounded up as many Christians as his minions could find, and either threw them to the lions for the entertainment of the crowds, or use them as human torches. Delightful. In spite of this, the Christian community survived to become the centre of world Christianity. They would have been aware of Paul's letter to them, in which he said, "Suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit." At that time, at the time Paul wrote his letter to the Romans, things weren't quite so bad for the Christian community. The previous emperor had ordered Christians to be expelled from Rome, but on his death, the order lapsed, and they were allowed to return. It wasn't an easy time, though. You never knew when they might be scapegoated again. Suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Endurance or perseverance is a theme that runs through many of Paul's letters. Indeed, he himself was a model of perseverance, endurance, and suffering, especially at the hands of the high priest in the synagogues and by the Romans. It says much about his courage that he didn't take the easy way out and just go back to being a Pharisee in the safety of the synagogue. So convinced was he of the gospel message that, in spite of everything, he held on to hope. As followers of a new religion, many of the early Christians suffered a great deal. It was almost taken as read by Paul, The Jews at that time persecuted them, just as Paul himself had done before his conversion. The Greeks and Romans worshipped a number of pagan gods, so they weren't impressed by the notion of only one God. Yet alongside this, many Jews, Greeks and Romans became Jesus' followers. Paul's willingness to suffer, endure, persevere, says much about the power of the gospel, the power of Jesus, the power of the Holy Spirit. Paul speaks of these things producing character and character producing hope. He says hope does not disappoint us because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. At this present time when the entire world is suffering, not from some unstable emperor or from those of other faiths, but from a deadly virus, we are all having to endure the situation as best we can. And whilst in Paul's letter he was acknowledging that it was the Christian community that was suffering, at present it is every community throughout the world that is suffering. But what does seem to be happening is that this suffering is indeed producing endurance for many people. We're seeing much character building and hope as communities pull together to help the most vulnerable. Supermarkets are providing priority deliveries for those who eschew them and for elderly and vulnerable people. Neighbours we may never have spoken to before are offering help should we need it. We're suddenly aware of just how important our NHS is. We acknowledge that all staff involved in healthcare are going above and beyond the call of duty, putting their own health and safety at risk to care for others. Or perhaps we're just realising that they've always done this, and it's given us pause for thought. We have no way of knowing how many of our NHS staff are Christians, how many are Jews, how many are Muslims or Sikhs, or how many have no religious belief whatsoever. But there is no doubt that they are willing to suffer, persevere and endure because they have hope. They have hope that their actions will save as many lives as humanly possible. Whether they're people of faith or not, they are instinctively demonstrating God's love, that love that has somehow been poured into their hearts by the Holy Spirit, even though they may be unaware of it. It may be that many of us are struggling to endure and hold on to hope, especially those who live alone and those who are completely confined to the four walls of home, and are likely to be so for some time to come. We're all missing our friends. We're all missing meeting together in church buildings. Maybe some of us are becoming depressed and anxious, wondering if we will ever get back to normal. But as Paul reminds us, suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. The horrific portrayal of the persecution of Christians in the film I watched helped remind me that in this country, we're free to follow the teachings of any faith. We can even become pagans or Wiccans if we want to, and no one will stop us. But it also reminded me of the work of an organisation that I support. It's called Open Doors, and it supports persecuted Christians in countries where Christianity is banned. Believe it or not, Christianity is the most persecuted religion in the world, particularly in Asia and parts of Africa. In many countries, Christians are forced to worship in secret, and if they're discovered, they face torture and even death. Torture and death for uttering just five words, "I believe in Jesus Christ." Not so different from the situation in Rome under the Emperor Nero all those centuries ago. Yet in these countries, such is the strength of converts' faith in Jesus that they're willing to take that risk, just as did Paul and the early Christians. They've clearly understood Paul's message that suffering produces endurance and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. We are so much more fortunate than the persecuted Christians in other countries. We may experience a bit of mockery from unbelievers. We may at times find our faith is a bit weak, especially at times like this when we're struggling to cope with worry and uncertainty. But at least we can comfort ourselves in the knowledge that no one is likely to knock on our door to arrest or torture us because we're Christians. We will not have to flee as refugees to another country to seek political asylum because the government is persecuting us, as has happened to many people from Pakistan. We're in lockdown for our own safety, not from persecution by the authorities, but from a virus that will in time be contained and for which a vaccine will be found. We can hope for the future, and perhaps we can have hope that some good might come out of this present situation. So let us remember again Paul's encouraging message: suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us once more come before God in prayer. Almighty God, for whom nothing is impossible and who cares for all his children, we come before you with our praise for our world, for our country and for ourselves. Lord, throughout this world pandemic, we have seen a coming together of people desiring to take care for the weak and the vulnerable. We've seen acts of kindness from ordinary people, brave and successful fundraising efforts by people for whom life is already difficult, including a 100-year-old former soldier and a 5-year-old double amputee, choosing to help others rather than giving in to their own problems. We pray that even after this pandemic is well under control and life beginning to return to normal, this sense of community and solidarity with your people will continue unabated. Although we cannot condone some of the violence and destruction that have taken place in countries throughout the world in response to the death of George Floyd, we pray that the protests against inequalities in so many countries of the world would result in a change of heart amongst racist individuals, organisations and governments. May those purporting to be Christians but failing to demonstrate your love recognise that every human life matters to you, that you did not discriminate, and nor did Jesus. As we continue on our journey towards an easing of lockdown, we ask that you would guide and strengthen our Scottish Government in the difficult decisions they need to make week by week. May we all accept that, like us, they are mere human beings, that they may inevitably make mistakes, but that they are working to the best of their ability to care for our country. Lord, we are aware that many people are becoming weary of the situation we're living in. Many are becoming depressed because they're isolated and unable to meet with their families. Give them strength and courage, Lord, and trust that you will lead us out of this situation in time. We pray too for ourselves, as we too need comfort, strength, and hope. And in a few moments of silence, we bring to you our personal prayers for those we know of who need prayer. Compassionate God, we ask your blessing on all those we have brought before you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We close our worship by singing together the hymn, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind.
Oh,
God's presence, and with it a sense of joy and hope and thankfulness. And may the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you and abide with you always. Amen.